Okay, today I'm going to talk about ethos, logos, and pathos, and I'm going to talk about them in conjunction with E.B. White's essay, Moonwalk. Ethos, logos, and pathos are three ways, the three major elements that you can break up an argumentative essay. Every argumentative essay will have those three components. Logos, let me do the logos part first. The logos part of an argumentative essay is basically the logical structure of it. I mean, once you kind of, if your essay, say, is 10 pages or 20 pages, you can take any long argument and summarize the basic argument in four or five sentences. You just say, this is my argument. And that's the and you set out the premises and the conclusion. That's the logos. That's the logical structure of it. You could take a writer, for example, could write a 400-page book on the causes of World War I. And if you asked him or her, you know, well, what's your argument? They can summarize it in a page or so, just leaving out all the 400 pages of, you know, illustrations and just get to the heart of the matter. Say, this is my argument. And they can list the premises and the conclusion. And show how everything fits together. That's the logos part of an argumentative essay, just focusing on the logical structure. On the other hand, you have ethos and pathos. Ethos refers, basically what ethos means is refers to anything in the essay or the book that establishes the author's credibility or integrity, trustworthiness. So whatever contributes to the trustworthiness of the author, you know, whatever makes the reader trust what the author is saying, that's what is included under this term ethos, and where we get the word ethics. Character, ethos refers to the character of the author. So ethos is directed towards the character. It's not directed towards the audience. It's directed towards the integrity of the trustworthiness of the author. Aristotle says, actually, this is the most important of all three because it doesn't really matter how good your argument is, how logical it is, or anything else, if the person you're talking to or the audience you're talking to doesn't trust you and they don't believe you. I mean, if they don't believe you and trust you, they're not going to believe what you say. So it's very important to gain the reader's trust. And when I go over E.B. White's Moonwalk, a very short essay, here's a copy. It's only nine sentences. I'll just show you. That's right. That's it. Nine sentences. E.B. White, Moonwalk. It's about when the astronauts landed on the moon, 1969. He was asked to criticize it, to give his take on the matter. And he came up with this little essay here, nine sentences. And in this essay that he wrote, it's a great essay for illustrating these three aspects, ethos, logos, and pathos. Pathos refers to everything in the essay that evokes feeling or in the reader or the audience, anything that evokes feeling or passion, emotion, that will lead the reader to feel emotionally involved in the issue. You know, not just abstractly, but to feel emotionally involved in it. And that's very important if you try to convince somebody of something, especially if you want them to do something. If you want them to contribute to your campaign, if politicians, for example, you want them to contribute to your campaign, to their campaign, if you want them to contribute money to your campaign, if you want them to do something, it's very emotionally, not simply to convince them intellectually, but you have to touch their heart. And that's what pathos does. So these all work together. A good argument is not simply logos. You know, having a little tightly knit argument is not going to be too persuasive unless you win over the minds and the hearts of your audience. You need to make them really feel and get involved in it. That's where pathos comes in. Ethos, logos, pathos. They're all essential. Now, when it comes to, for example, scientific papers, it's basically in scientific papers and mathematical proofs, the pathos and ethos mean nothing. It's scientific papers are basically logos. That's all that matters because scientists are not, they just want to know They want to know what your theory is, and they want to know if you can prove it. They're not interested in being, you know, emotionally involved in the issue, or they're not interested in the character of the person. All that matters to them is the proof. Does it work? For example, when Einstein wrote his paper to show that E equals MC squared, believe me, physicists were not interested in ethos and pathos. They were interested in Einstein's argument. You know, does he prove his point? That's all physicists care about. That's all mathematicians care about. But when you're outside of these purely abstract disciplines like logic and mathematics, and you're in the real world where people debate things like the death penalty, abortion, and so on, all three of these elements come into play. Later on, we're going to be talking about Martin Luther King's letter from Birmingham jail. In that letter that he wrote from jail, all three elements interact, and they're very, very important, because Martin Luther King wanted his audience. He was writing to Martin Luther King was a Baptist minister. He was writing to other ministers, Catholic, Jewish, and Protestant, and he wanted them to join his campaign. He wanted them to actually, you know, put their lives on the line and join his campaign against discrimination. And he needed to make his audience feel the pain that black people suffer from discrimination. It's not enough simply to win some intellectual argument. So anyway, when we talk about that essay, I'll also talk about ethos, logos, and pathos. But at this point, I want to talk about these in terms of Moonwalk by E.B. White. I'm going to read it. It's only 9 sentences. He wrote this in 1969. He was in Maine. It was around midnight. He was watching TV, the landing. This is when Armstrong and Aldrin landed on the moon. His job for the, I think it was a New Yorker, but I may be mistaken. He was working for a journal, and his job was to report on the moon landing and to come up with a short piece. He came up with this essay. It's only 9 sentences, but it took him like it took him like 8 hours to do this. And if you could read this, this says draft 6. So he, before the final draft that he wrote, he actually wrote 5 other drafts. So there's a lot of rewriting in this essay. When you get to the final draft, every word in here in this essay, every word, every little punctuation mark, he thought about. So I'm going to read the essay, and then I'll talk about it very briefly. I may spend another video going over some of the details. Here's 9 sentences. The moon, it turns out, is a great place for men. That's the first sentence. 1/6 gravity must be a lot of fun. And when Armstrong and Aldrin went into their bouncy little dance like two happy children, it was a moment not only of triumph, but of gaiety. The moon, on the other hand, is a poor place for flags. Ours look stiff and awkward, trying to float on the breeze that does not blow. And then in parentheses, he says, there must be a lesson here somewhere. Okay, now we're to sentence 6. It is traditional, of course, for explorers to plant the flag, but it struck us, as we watched with awe and admiration and pride, that our two fellows were universal men, not national men, and should have been equipped accordingly. Like every great river and every great sea, the moon belongs to none and belongs to all. It still holds the key to madness, still controls the tides that lap on shores everywhere, still guards the levers that kiss in every land under no banner but the sky. And then his last sentence, sentence 9. What a pity that in our moment of triumph, we did not forswear the familiar Iwo Jima saying and plant instead a device acceptable to all, a limp white handkerchief, perhaps symbol of the common cold, which, like the moon, affects us all, unites us all. Okay, beautiful essay, beautiful. I mean, this is 6 drafts. If you go back and look at all the previous 5 drafts and actually follow it step by step by step, the way all the different rewritings he did, you'll be totally amazed. So maybe I'll talk about it some other time how that happens, but I just want to focus on draft 6. First of all, I think I'll just right now I'm just going to focus on what his argument is. I mean, I'll focus on the logos part, and then next lecture I'll focus on other elements, because I can't really do this in justice's essay in 15 minutes. First of all, when you read something like this, you know, it's when you read it, a good idea when you read anything is just, okay, when you read it, put it down. Don't look at it. In your own words, try to at least, you know, in your own words, try to identify what the conclusion is. What's the main point that he's making? Conclusion. And then why? You know, what's the premise? What the reason or reasons that lead to the conclusion? So basically, I just read it to you. The final sentence is, what a pity that in our moment of triumph, we did not forswear the familiar Iwo Jima scene and plant instead a device acceptable to all, a limp white handkerchief, perhaps a symbol of the common cold, which, like the moon, affects us all, unites us all. That's the last sentence. Now, if you put it aside, you know, a lot of times when I've taught this before, I ask students, you know, what's the argument, they'll look at it, you know, really closely. But the best thing to do is just put it aside and just, if imagine like one of your friends says, you know, you just read it. What was the point? What was he saying? What was his big point? What was his big point? That's what you want to focus on. You don't have to go back and look at every little word. Just put in your own words. Well, okay, it's pretty simple in this case. If you said, what is his big point? I would just say, look at, he wasn't happy. He wasn't happy with what we did on the moon. That's he thought we should have done something different. He watched the moon landing. He watched us plant the American flag, and he wasn't happy about it. So I'll read it again. We put the flag there. What a pity that in a moment of triumph, we did not forswear the familiar Iwo Jima scene and plant instead a device acceptable to all. And then he tells you we should have put a limp white handkerchief. So the conclusion is, you can put it in your own words. It doesn't really matter. You know, just the big idea is that he wasn't happy. We regarding the United States, should not have placed the American flag, place the American flag on the moon. Okay, now he doesn't put it exactly that way. The American flag, sorry about that, on the moon. Okay, that's his big point. We should not have placed the American flag on the moon. We should have put something there that everyone could have been happy about. What a pity that in our moment of triumph, we did not forswear the, I'll talk about the Iwo Jima part in another lecture. We did not forswear the familiar Iwo Jima scene and plant instead a device acceptable to all. So basically the bottom line is this, what's his main point? We should not have placed the American flag on the moon. We should have placed something that everybody could, you know, identify with. And he says, perhaps, you could come up with your own choice. He says, you know, perhaps a handkerchief, a limp white handkerchief might have been better than the flag. Now you say, first of all, that is his argument. Now, first of all, when you just hear it for the first time, it's kind of weird. Now you can imagine, one question that immediately arises, in an essay, and this is a very short essay, it's only 9 sentences, he could have told you that he could have started his essay out with the first sentence saying, you know, he could have told you exactly what he believed. We made a mistake. We should not have planted an American flag on the moon. We should have planted maybe a limp white handkerchief. He doesn't. He waits to the very end of the essay. Now just think about that. This type of essay is called a funnel essay, it's like a funnel. It's called funnel essay because it's like a funnel. Or a funnel paragraph, but basically it's a one paragraph essay. A funnel essay or funnel paragraph is where you put your thesis at the very end, and you lead up to it, la 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 la, and the reader doesn't know where you're going with it until the very last sentence. And you tell them what your point is. One reason he does this is because his thesis may offend many people. I mean, if he told you right off the bat that, oh, we should not have placed the American flag on the moon, we should play the flag. A lot of people, you know, this is during the Vietnam War and stuff, and this is a lot of people, you know, if you don't love America, leave it. If you don't love America, then leave it. You leave it. So that could have offended many people, you know, like, why, would you hate America? You don't want our flag on the moon? No, so what E.B. White does is he tells you what his thesis is. He waits till the end, but in the meantime, what he does is he wins you over to his viewpoint. So when he actually states his conclusion, his thesis, you may disagree with him, but you're not going to hate him. You're going to say, wow, that was pretty interesting. I have to think about that.